Hi, and welcome to part 9 of my PowerShell tutorial series. In the last video, we went over a couple of the loops in PowerShell, all the for each loops in PowerShell. We went over the method version, the commandlet, and then just the very standard for each loop. Today, we're going to be looking at other types of loops today. So, we're going to be looking at the for loop, the while loop, the do while, and the do until loop. The last two are very, very short, very basic loops. The first two, there are some things to look out for and some purposes to them. So let's actually start and let's take a look at these. So we're just always going to set up our strict mode. So the first loop here that we're going to be looking at is going to be the for loop. So it's very similar to the for each loop. But as I mentioned in the last video, the for each loop goes over series of objects, whereas the for loop will really execute that block of code x times. So we set the amount of times that we want that loop to execute, and it will execute that many times. So let's take a quick look here at what that would look like. So we start off that loop by typing in for, and then an open and close parentheses. And then we have our counter, our index. Typically, in most programming languages, you'll see that as being an I or a P variable. So we're going to set that to our dollar sign I, and we're going to initialize that variable to 0. And then we're going to do a semicolon, and then we're going to do a dollar sign I, and we're going to do less than 10, and then another semicolon, dollar sign I plus plus. So what that is the first part initializes our variable or our counter I to 0. Our second is the condition that we want to check against. So we always want to make sure that the dollar sign I is under 10. And then our last part is our increment. So this tells PowerShell to increment I by 1 every time the loop goes through an iteration. So then we'll have our open and close curly brackets here. And then all we're going to do is we're just going to print out the I variable. So if we run this here, we're going to see that it prints out the numbers 0 through 9, which is expected because we start at 0 and we want to do this loop as long as it's less than 10, not less than and equals to 10, because if we did this to lesser or equals to 10, and we ran the loop, we would see that we do get to 10. But I said that we just wanted to do less than 10. So that is awesome. Now, what we can do in these types of cases, especially with our names file that we have. So let me just get that line of code here from our last video here. So we have our file path and our names, which get us the names. And as we can see here, we have our names Tim, John, Paul, Mike, and Thomas. So, what we can actually do here is we can have another for loop with our I as 0. And then this time we're going to do our dollar sign I is less than our variable names dot length. So, we want to make sure that it stays under the total length of names, which is actually our array of names. And then we're going to increment I by 1 again, and then we're going to do our open and close curly brackets. And then what we're actually going to do is we are simply going to print out the name here. And here we can see we get Tim, John, Paul, Mike, and Thomas. So, if we did our very similar example to our last video here, we can do get content and a file path of C data names, then reference a variable here, and we're going to put in our array and then config dot text. That in here. Sorry about that. So if we run this here, we're going to see that we get our config files for Tim, John, Paul, and Mike and Thomas. So now, compared to our for each loop, we knew that we couldn't change the actual values of our array in names. But what we could do with this here is if we just copy paste this loop, and then we go in here, and then we can actually do names, and then we reference our I for our index. We can actually change the value to test and then I. So we'll have test 0 through test 4 here. So let's execute this. We get no output because we're not outputting anything, but we're actually changing the values of names. And now if we want to print out the list of names now we see that we get test 0, test 1, test 2, test 3, test 4. So we can actually change this, and then we would be able to output this to the file if that's what we wanted to do, is go through all the names and change them to something. Now, the other type of loop, like we've mentioned here, is the while loop. So what that does is it checks a condition first, then it will do the block of code inside of it, and then it will keep executing until that condition is no longer true. So what that looks like here, if we do while and we have a condition, and then we'll have an open and close curly brackets. So if we do here, we're going to have a condition, which if we look at the time here, I can see the time, but you guys will not be able to see the time. So let me just get the date here. We see that it is Tuesday, May 4th at 9:55. So what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to do a get date dot minute is equal to 56, and then we are just going to print out, we are just going to get the date constantly. So what this is going to do, we see that this will constantly execute the get date commandlet while our get date minute is equal to 56. So as long as it's the 56 minute of any hour, we're not specifying hour or date or anything like that, it will keep getting the date. So if we let this run here for a little bit, there's only about 20 seconds left, we will see that when it switches to 57, we won't actually see it switch to 57. But then the loop will stop. So we have about 10 seconds left here to go, and we will actually see it stop. And there it is. So we see that right after this, it switched over to 9:57. So if I actually just run the get date command here, we see that it is 9:57. So what we could use this is, let's say you had a server for some reason that is offline, and you want to make sure that you get something off of it when it comes back online, or you have a service that you want to make sure that it is always running. So you can always have these while loops constantly checking a condition, and then if that condition is met, you execute something. You can even have, like, use some not operators to add some logic into there, but just know that the condition is always checked first, and then the code runs within, and then the condition is checked again, and it keeps running. So if ever you do have a loop here which you know will last forever, you can always have a break statement break out of it, and that'll only have it run once. Now, the other type of loops, which is very similar to the while loops, is going to be the do while loops. So this here will have a do and then an open and close curly brackets. And then while after the close curly brackets, and then we'll have our condition. Now, what happens here is we actually do what's inside this code block first, and then we check the condition. So no matter what, it will be ran at least once, but it can be ran multiple times. So if we actually have, if we just put an output here, as write output. We're just going to do high, and we have while false. In theory, if we did while false up here and we did the same write output, we will see that this will not run. We don't get the high because the false statement is checked first, and we know that this never executes, but the do while false will actually execute once. Then it checks the while condition, it sees that it's false, it then breaks out of that loop. So again, that's something that's very useful if you at least want to execute the code once, or you have to execute such code to be able to check the condition properly, you would want to use the do while loop. Now, there's one last kind of loop here, which is actually the do until loop. So here we have the do open and close curly brackets until, and then we have a condition. Now, what this is, this will continuously execute the code inside of the curly brackets until the condition is met. So as long as this condition is false, the code will actually execute. So it's a bit of the opposite of the do while loop, but the code will still execute once. So let's actually do this here. If we do until dollar sign true with a write output of high, we will actually see that it will only run once. But if we do a dollar sign false here, we'll actually see that we get into an infinite loop. So it's always important to remember, depending on which do while or do until loop you actually execute, you're going to want to make sure that you're interpreting the condition correctly. Because if not, you could run into an infinite loop situation. But as long as you put proper breaks in, you should be fine. And as long as you know for sure that the condition will eventually be satisfied and exit out of the loop, you should also be well, unless you do want to have an infinite loop. If your service is running and you constantly want to be checking something like some sort of heartbeat monitor, where you always want to make sure that you can ping a server. If you cannot ping a server, it's got to do something until it can again. Those types of situations do come up. As long as you know what you're coding for and you know the conditions, and know if you want to have an infinite loop or not, use the proper loops, use the proper conditions, and then everything will be great and you won't have to write tons of lines of code to execute that. Now, in our next couple videos, we're going to be all going over some errors and some different types of error handling in PowerShell. And that'll basically be the end of our beginner tutorial series. And then we'll start going into some more advanced topics like creating our own functions, creating our own modules, testing out our scripts, and making just larger scripts, and really starting to work with Active Directory and server objects a little bit more. I will see you on the next video.